And believe it or not, I'm on the board of ordained ministry. I get to examine other people and maybe I'll figure it out. So from Mark's account of the gospel, we have a series of four events recorded that happened on the same Sabbath day or on the morning after that first Sabbath. Beginning on the 21st verse, they went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It was just another Sabbath day in Capernaum. Nothing that they hadn't already done, going back hundreds, if not a thousand years or more. They had come to a place designated by the community as being set apart for holy purposes. They came in, they sat down, maybe they had their coffee or their espresso. Thank you for laughing, that was... They made small talk. Maybe they hadn't seen each other since the last Sabbath day. And then it began, the liturgy, the work of the people. They read scripture. They heard somebody expound upon it. They prayed. Perhaps they took an offering. They did things that holy people are supposed to do when they come together. But then in their midst, there stood, or rather there sat, because in the ancient world, the teacher sat, the students stood. Maybe we should try that sometime. Time for it. Yeah. And Jesus, one of them, a Jew, a brother, and he stood and he taught them and expounded upon whatever the lesson was that day, and he did it with such awareness of the source of his reading that it overwhelmed them. And it was one of those wow moments that if you're lucky or blessed, you get to experience at least once in your life. And they said to one another, "What is this? This is amazing. This is one of those things where you get to say, yay God, I get it." Because they had gotten so used to coming in, sitting down, being entertained for an hour, and then going off about their business as if nothing had happened. But for the first time, perhaps, in their lives, they had been touched by the holy and could not leave that place as they had come in. Now, I don't know about you, but I have been fortunate over the years to have gone to some amazing historical buildings set aside for religious purposes. There's some you walk into and you just sense there's something happening here. This morning, as is my habit, I came into the sanctuary to do my thing. If you ever want to see what my thing is, come about 5:30 and you'll see it. Yeah, right. Now, when I come into the building, come in through the front door, and I have a sequence of things that I do. I turn on the heat in the library. Then I walk through the door and I turn on the heat. Then I open the door, unlock the door to the parking lot. Then I turn on the heat in the fellowship hall. Then I turn on the coffee pot. No, I don't do that first. And then I come into the sanctuary and turn on the heat here so it's nice and toasty for you. And then I go make my coffee. Well, this morning, for whatever reason, I came into the sanctuary about 7:30, and it was cold because I had forgotten to turn the heat off. I mean, immediately I went to the beach and ran up, skipped up, and turned the heat off. There are times when you come into a place, into a worship service, and you feel cold. There's nothing happening. You bring nothing in, you take nothing out. There are other times when it doesn't matter who the preacher is, who the singers are, you know that you have been in a holy place and leave there with power. On this occasion, Jesus came into the sanctuary, into the synagogue, and brought the power with him. Because he had spent his life up to that moment absorbing the lessons of his people, absorbing the purpose of the Torah, absorbing the power of God, the power that when men and women of every station, of every culture, when they are touched by God, things happen. He brought the power with him, and when he left, he took the power with him. Now, when you read this, I mean, let's be honest. We're living in the 21st century of the common era. We are sophisticated. We are wise. We have in our pockets or our purses more technology than existed, well, until Bill Gates said we could. And yet, we lack all too often the simple power of God. We have access to knowledge, but we lack wisdom. We have But I'm trying to cut to the chase. Jesus came into the synagogue that day. bringing the power of God with him. He taught as someone who expected God to be in his word. And when someone, unnamed, stood and challenged him, he said, come out. Be quiet. The reason this is so important for us here in the 21st century, in the first century, something like this happened. If you were sick, it was because you had sinned. If you were had a mental or emotional or spiritual issue, it was because you were possessed. Now, with a few exceptions, the majority of Christians in the world today understand this as not demonic possession, but as an absence of God in that person's life. Now, I don't know where each of you sit this morning on this issue, but the bottom line was, this person was troubled when they were confronted by the power of God. And they knew that once you're confronted with the power of God, something is going to happen. You can't have a face-to-face with God and expect to go about your business as if nothing had happened. And Jesus told the man, the demon, the issue, go away. You have no place here. In the presence of God, you are defeated. Depart. And everybody there, not just the person who had been possessed, every person there knew that they, too, had been in the presence of God. This was not something that they went out to Frontier Cafe and looked at the menu and didn't talk about it. This was one of those moments that you can, well, I started to say bet your bottom dollar, but you're not going to bet. Yeah, they didn't have dollars, so it's okay. You can bet their bottom dollar that someone talked about this on the way home that day. So the question for us this morning is, when you encounter God in your life, do you tell anybody about it? Do you share that God came into your life, challenged those things that were blocking or preventing you from truly living? Or do you leave whatever assembly there is as if this was just another day? Because 1900 plus years later, we're still talking about this. We're still saying, yes, God exists. Yes, I believe in God. But remember, even the demons believe in God. Even the demons are aware of who Jesus is. They understand what they're confronting. Do we Christians understand who we are confronted with and by? When you leave here today and you're basking in the glow of music, and you lit candles, and you said prayers, and you brought your offering before God, and you had the delicious coffee, and tasted the scrumptious treats that had been lovingly prepared in some bakery in Toledo. If I'm wrong, we'll find out. And will you wake up tomorrow morning and, what is my life going to be like today? Will it be the same as you woke up this morning? No change. Or will you wake up tomorrow morning having experienced everything that this day offers, and you say, because of yesterday, today means something else. Tomorrow, by the grace of God, will be different. That had I not had God in my life then, I cannot live today. And because you're alive, and because you've experienced God, and because you read a story like this and you say, sure, that's how they understood their world. That's how they experienced and explained what had happened. Some generation, years from now, when Isla's great-grandchildren think about God, will they have an awareness of what you have experienced? Will they be able to say, you know, because of Sue or Fran, or yes, even Lynn, because of their sharing of their faith, my faith is real. The choice is ours. The choice is real, and it is immediate.